this word transitory gets bandied around a lot at the moment. Transitory for us is not a matter of months, but it's not years and years either. So the reason we expect it to be transitory is twofold. Firstly, the rise in the base effect. So that goes all the way back to having negative oil prices last year, which was tremendously deflationary. That destroys the year-on-year data basket. So you've got these really negative numbers. And as they fall out and we load in normalized numbers, clearly the whole thing lifts massively. That's basically just occurred. So that is the inflation hill. And we wrote a white paper about that earlier in the year. So that's definitely gone, mathematically gone. That's the easy bit. The harder bit is working out what's going to hang around as a result of these supply blockages. So we know that they've been intense, you know, as we've gone through rolling lockdowns around the world. We know that as everybody comes out of lockdown, they all want to do the same thing together, which is get the hell away from where they've been locked down and travel and, you know, seeing things like airfares and lodging away from home, car rentals. You know, these prices have gone through the roof. That's pretty understandable, I think. But there is a point at which, if they continue to rise, that we'll see severe demand destruction. You know, you're simply just not going to go on holidays where you paid $200 or $300 or $400 a night for accommodation if it's at $700, $800, $900, you know, and keeps rising. So inflation needs to be continuously rising. I think as a result of what we've gone through, we've seen some one-off price increases, no doubt. But the sustainability of that, we think, you know, will come into question and should moderate back to trend once we get through this reopening process. You know, we've had huge amounts of logistical challenges. We've had all, you know, shipping containers on the wrong side of the world. We've had blockages in the Suez Canal. You know, everything we could throw at these logistical supply chains has simply occurred. And it's just picked up the jigsaw and thrown it in the air. And the pieces have landed all over the floor in regard to the jigsaw puzzle. So we do need to let that calm down. And we think that transient will result out of that. I'm pretty sure the next question you're going to ask me is, do central bankers care about that? And I think transient can hang around just long enough to be uncomfortable for central bankers. And that can force potentially a policy error. We've seen them do it plenty of times in the past. You know, we've seen the Fed obviously be a little bit more aggressive about their take on average inflation targeting. And so that in doing that, clearly they're destroying future inflation expectation in terms of market pricing. But it is a little bit problematic for them. It's just elevated enough and it's not going to fall away quickly. After the GFC, we saw this kind of inflation hang around for, you know, kind of 6 to 12 months. And certainly, you know, we're not at day one, but it is just hanging around a little bit. And we do expect it to moderate. We don't see, you know, broad secular changes in the inflationary environment. But there's lots of these one-offs and they're going to take some time to moderate out. So there's three, you know, very obvious ways to get sustainable inflation. One is to have a really big war. One is to have a really big energy crisis. Or the third one, which we'd all hope for, is to have full employment. And we really do need that full employment in order to get there. I think, you know, options one and two don't look very desirable for anybody. Option three would be fantastic, but there is enormous amounts of spare capacity in economies. We know that a lot of these jobs that have been destroyed as a result of lockdown, they're not likely to come back quickly. So we're still some ways away from that. Now that's a bit different here. We've got closed borders at the moment. Obviously, prior to this Delta outbreak that we're experiencing at the moment, our employment situation was looking really good because we don't have to have this crowding out effect from all of these internationals coming in to fill you know, a lot of these openings. But yeah, I think that full employment's the obvious one. In Australia today, you know, essentially the whole East Coast up to the Sunshine Coast from Melbourne is in lockdown or some form of rolling lockdown. You know, we're a ways away. We've been such, you know, we're so early in our COVID journey via the suppression strategy. We'll be one of the last out, whereas a lot of other countries that have had, you know, chaotic and brutal COVID experiences, they have at least passed through them now. So thinking of places like the UK, you've either had it or you've been vaccinated. You know, one way or another, you've got some immunity. They're going to be moving on beyond COVID, similarly in the US. In Oz, we're going to just have to, it's just going to take more time. And certainly it doesn't look like, you know, government policy will change around living with COVID anytime soon. So frustratingly, we're going to be one of the last out. And that's going to be, you know, complex for our own employment situation.